Welcome to online worship for Peace United Church of Christ, October 25th, 2020.
Hi, welcome to Peace Online Worship. There are two important things I need to let you know about. First, originally we were planning on opening the church for worship on November 1st of this year, 2020. But because of the increasing numbers of COVID cases and hospitalizations, we have decided that we're going to delay that until the 15th of November, but keep posted or keep your ear to the ground, listen to our postings and our announcements about that, because we're going to evaluate that as we go along. The other thing, and also related to our inability to be together, is the fact that our annual fall stewardship pledge drive is going to be delayed too, because we want to be able to meet together to collect cards and to talk about our stewardship gifts to the church and so forth. So that's going to be delayed also. But like I said, keep your ear to the ground, look at announcements, read our messenger newsletter, and read our weekly email. Stay tuned. We will let you know when things happen. Thank you.
All hail the power of Jesus' name, let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown Christ, servant of all. Attend the Savior's sovereign claim and crown Christ, servant of all. Adorn, O martyred saints of old, the coronation hall. Extol the wounded one for gold and crown Christ, bearer of all. Extol the wounded one for gold and crown Christ, bearer of all. All heirs of Israel's chosen race, now ransomed from the fall, proclaim the wonders of God's grace and crown Christ, healer of all. Proclaim the wonders of God's grace and crown Christ, healer of all. Before the cross with heaven's throng, we on our knees shall fall. We'll join the everlasting song and crown Christ, Savior of all. We'll join the everlasting song and crown Christ, Savior of all.
Our responsive call to worship. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Take in the air around you. Give thanks to God for this day.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Celebrate the beauty of the day that God has made.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Let us worship the Lord. Our first reading is from the Old Testament of Leviticus. The Lord also said to Moses, "Give the following instructions to the entire community of Israel. You must be holy because I, the Lord, your God, am holy. You shall not render an unjust judgment. You shall not be partial to the poor or defer to the great. With justice, you shall judge your neighbor. You shall not go around as a slanderer among your people, and you shall not profit by the blood of your neighbor. I am the Lord. You shall not hate in your heart anyone of your kin. You shall reprove your neighbor, or you will incur guilt yourself. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against any of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." Feel free to pause the video between the prayers and pray on your own. Psalm 103 says, "All that I am, praise the Lord. Everything in me, praise his holy name." Pause a moment to give honor to God.
Our message this day is from 1 Thessalonians, which opens with these words: "We always thank God for all of you and mention you when we pray." Thank God now for the people in your life.
We read a moment ago God's desire for us to be holy. Focus in prayer on that part of your life that is not, being honest to God who you really are.
As always, many people in our church family are in need of prayer. We have some new concerns. We have updated concern for some who have been on our prayer list for quite a while. No doubt you also know of others who need a special touch from God at this time. Take a moment to lift them up to the Lord in prayer.
Pray to God whatever is in your heart.
And now join us in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our second reading is from the New Testament, Book of Thessalonians. "You yourselves know, brothers and sisters, that our coming to you was not in vain, but though we had already suffered and been shamefully mistreated at Philippi, as you know, we had courage in our God to declare to you in the gospel of God, in spite of great opposition. For our appeal does not spring from deceit or impure motives or trickery, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the message of the gospel, even so we speak, not to please mortals, but to please God, who tests our hearts. As you know, and as God is our witness, we never came with words of flattery or with a pretext for greed, nor did we seek praise from mortals, whether from you or from others, though we might have made demands as apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, like a nurse tenderly caring for her own children. So deeply do we care for you that we are determined to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you have become very dear to us.
Do you know this song? Take a listen.
Then you couldn't make things new just by saying I love you. La-di-da, more than words. La-di-da, la-di-da.
You might know that song. It's about a guy who doesn't really want to hear the words, I love you, because he wants the person that he loves to show him. Then she wouldn't have to say it because he would already know. I've always been puzzled by that song, actually, because I want to hear from the people that I love the words, I love you. It's nice to hear. Oh, I know there was a guy that for 40 years didn't tell his wife that he loved her, and then all of a sudden one day she said, you never say that you love me. And he says, well, of course, I told you when we got married that I loved you, and I haven't changed my mind since. I think most of us like to hear that. But the song does make a good point that love doesn't become real until we actually show it. And it's not just romantic love I'm talking about. I'm talking about demonstrating the love of Christ, for example, that we can do in the church to the rest of the community. You know, we've all heard that little cliche where people in the church say, God loves you and so do we. But so often, the people who are the subject of our love don't know that. Perhaps it's because we don't show it well enough. That, my dear friends, is where integrity comes in. It's making sure that we not only intend to love people in our church, in our community, to those around us, but actually doing it. In our scripture passage today from 1 Thessalonians, Paul tells the people that he dearly loves that he didn't come to them with some highfalutin speech, but his presentation sprang from pure motives, loving motives. And that's what it takes to be a real disciple of Jesus Christ. It's about integrity, and it's about accomplishing what God has called us to do. It's one that I'm very sensitive to, because I get so tired of hearing people leave the church because they felt like people within that church did not love them adequately. Sometimes our intentions are good, but our execution is not. Or sometimes we think we are loving, but in reality, the other people don't really understand that what we're trying to do is very loving. So it's about integrity. Now, integrity has been defined as doing the right thing even when nobody is looking. That's a great definition. It has been attributed to C.S. Lewis, but I don't think he actually said that. But that's all right. But I decided to look that up and find out whether C.S. Lewis said that or not, because I want to preach with integrity. I want my facts to be straight. But whether he said it or not, it's a helpful definition. So there are three parts to integrity that I want to talk about today that really stem from doing what God has called us to do and not just saying that we're doing it. First of all, integrity has to do with actually accomplishing what we have been called to do. The Apostle Paul was always very concerned with fulfilling the calling that he believed that God was asking him to do, and that is to spread the love of Christ, spread the gospel to those around him in various ways. He was so focused on getting that task done that even when he understood that people were spreading the gospel in ways that might hurt him, that was okay with him. He says in the letter to the church in Philippians chapter 1, he says, Others proclaim Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, but intending to increase my suffering and my imprisonment. What does it matter? Just this, that Christ is proclaimed in every way, whether out of false motives or true, and in that I rejoice. Yes, and I will continue to rejoice. So he was very motivated to accomplish that very task that he believed that he was called to do. I've known church folks that really don't care much whether we accomplish what God is calling us as a body of Christ to do. They just want a position of prominence, or they just want to do their thing, rather than understanding what God is calling the church to do and actually doing whatever it takes to get it done. It's not just a team effort, it's a body effort. So my prayer for our congregation is that we be focused on doing what God is calling us to do. But the other aspect, the second aspect I want to talk about is why we do it. What motivates us to do the work God is calling us to do? We are often put in a position to defend why we do something bad, right? For example, a kid might say in response to the question, why did you do that? Or why didn't you do that? They might say something like, I felt like it. But, you know, we have all done that, or we have all felt that need to defend our actions in some way, or defend our actions, whether they're bad or actually good. I mean, maybe you've had people come over and you know, it's around supper time, and you say, you can stay for dinner. And they say, I don't want to impose. And then we say something really odd, I think. Well, you know, whatever's left over is just going to throw away anyway. Give it to the dogs or whatever. And it sounds not much like we value their friendship, whereas what we're actually doing is valuing their friendship. We want them to dine with us and be together, at least in normal times, not in the pandemic year. But it is important to understand why we are doing that. It seems sometimes we diminish the value of friendships, at least in words, but is it something that we really think about? Is, you know, what motivates us to do what we do? When we do good things, most of us really do it for very good reasons. That's what's going on in the scripture passage today. Paul is motivated by the need to share the gospel, not so that he would look like a really smart guy, not the possibility of his own gain, but he was motivated to make sure that whatever he did was out of pure motives to share the gospel of Christ. Without fully realizing it, though, sometimes we tend to judge other people more harshly than we judge ourselves. There's a professor of psychology at University of Louisville who says that we often do that because we tend to look at the outward actions of other people. And if it fails badly, you know, we tend to blame them. But for our own actions, we look at our motivation. And we so often think that we are motivated by the most noblest of causes. So we tend to overlook the faults of other people or of ourselves and exaggerate the faults of other people. I think we need to be a little easier on other people. In fact, Jesus tells that parable that we tend to point out the speck in other people's eyes and ignore the log, the beam in our own eyes. But it has to do with being motivated to do the right thing, not just doing the right thing, but doing it for the right reason. But it's not just why we do things. The last point I want to make about integrity, it has to do with who we do them for. Of course, it is our calling, so we're doing it for God. We serve God faithfully, and that's what Paul talks about with himself. Paul is clearly motivated by the single most important thing being sharing the gospel of Christ with other people and fulfilling the calling. That's what motivates him. He says, in fact, we're not trying to please people, but we're trying to please God. And that's a great motivation. But it goes beyond that, because we need to be motivated by our love for people, our genuine love for people. I love the letter of 1 Thessalonians, because Paul really reflects a deep, compassionate tenderness for these people. It's interesting, in the ancient world, nurturing was usually done by the mother, and instruction in virtue and socialization was usually taken over by the father. Well, Paul applies himself to both dimensions here. In Galatians chapter 4, he says, "My dear children, for whom I am again in the pains of childbirth until Christ is formed in you." And he talks about how he nurtures them. And then he also talks about how, like a father, he seeks to instruct them as well. We need to be motivated by the love we have for people, the deep, deep love of the people around us. One of my prayers, my constant prayers, is that we here at Peace Church love each other so deeply that what we end up doing in terms of ministry is a natural outgrowth of that love for each other. So let me close by asking about you. And you can ask yourself these questions. The three basic questions we talked about in terms of integrity are: what are you doing? Why are you doing it? And who are you doing it for?